really proud and honored to be here to help you continue your 50th anniversary celebration this year. But you may not realize that yesterday was another 50th for you. June 9, 2003 was actually the day when the coalition officially certified St. Paul's UCC Mechanicsburg as ONA Church number 464. And more than 1,000 congregations have followed your example since then. On Wednesday last week, the coalition certified ONA Church number 1530, another St. Paul's in Selinsgrove. In 2003, you were showing the way for churches in Pennsylvania and beyond. You are part of the largest and fastest growing LGBT church affirming movement in the world. In the past 15 years, you have restored many lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender exiles to the body of Christ, and whether or not you know it, you have saved lives. So your invitation to share this Sunday with you is and this is a day of celebration not only for you, but for the entire open and affirming movement. And we need these occasions of celebration, especially in a time like this. You all know what it feels like to gather for a birthday or an anniversary against the background of a personal or family tragedy. And today we are lighting 15 birthday candles in the shadows of a country torn apart by hatred and war. So far this year, mass shootings have claimed the lives of 112 Americans, including 15 teenagers at Stoneman Douglas High School in Parkland, Florida. So while today we celebrate this congregation, how does our celebration honor them? Or how do we honor the LGBT Americans who last year lost federal protection against job discrimination? Or the transgender soldiers who faced expulsion from the armed forces? Or the Central American women, victims of rape, seeking sanctuary only to be turned back at our door? Today, we celebrate not in spite of, but because of these events. Today, you are remembering the covenant. And in that act of memory, renewing the promises you made 15 years ago. Especially now, this week, this year, and the difficult years to come, we need those promises and the values they represent. So, today I want to talk with you about covenant. The Lord appeared to Abraham by the oaks of Mamre as he sat at the entrance of his tent in the heat of the day. He looked up and saw three strangers standing near him. For centuries, Christians have interpreted the story of Abraham and Sarah and the three travelers as an encounter with the Trinity. There are three strangers, so the math is right. Like the Trinity, they're very mysterious. Andrei Rublev, a Russian artist who painted an icon of the story in the 15th century, imagined the three travelers sitting under the oaks of Mamre at a table covered with food. But Abraham and Sarah are absent. The icon is called Troitsa, Russian for Trinity. But another, more ancient icon shows the same scene, but with Sarah and Abraham there serving the three strangers. And this is the icon at the front door of my home. The title is the Greek word for hospitality, philoxenia, which translated literally means love for the stranger. Love for the stranger. For some of us, the depth of a church's welcome is a matter of life and death. Three strangers arrived out of the wilderness, hungry, thirsty, and tired. If Abraham and Sarah had turned them away, that could have been a death sentence. The moral code of the ancient Near East imposed an obligation on the host. Following this code, Abraham ran from his tent. Now, notice he didn't sit and wait for the strangers to come to him. He ran out to them. And then he bowed deeply. And that probably means more than a nod of the head. It's more likely Abraham prostrated himself on the ground and kissed the feet of his guests. And then a truly extravagant feast was prepared as if they were royalty. There was drink for their thirst and food for their hunger. The strangers, of course, were divine messengers. But the story makes no distinction between them and God. The Lord appeared to Abraham by the oaks of Mamre, as he sat at the entrance of his tent in the heat of the day. He looked up and saw three strangers standing near him. This dance between the one and the three continues throughout the story. It's no wonder our ancestors in faith came to believe Abraham and Sarah's encounter with the mysterious visitors prefigured the doctrine of the Trinity, because they believed it was God coming out of the desert in the guise of three strangers, God coming to them hungry, thirsty, and tired. Now, like other stories, the story of Abraham and Sarah has a beginning, a middle, and an end. The strangers arrive, they accept Abraham's hospitality, something else goes on, and then they depart. Paul, in his letter to the Romans, invites the church to practice this ancient moral code, but with a different outcome. What if the strangers arrive, but never leave? What if the story of hospitality, philoxenia, has a beginning, but no end? In most Bibles, like the one we read from today, Romans chapter 15, verse 7 is translated as welcome. Welcome one another, therefore, just as Christ has welcomed you for the glory of God. But I prefer a different translation, and it goes like this. Accept one another. Accept one another, just as Christ accepted you, in order to bring praise to God. There's a difference between welcome and accept. Sometimes I think of welcome as friendliness, a handshake and a smile when a visitor walks into the church. And friendliness is very important, as you know. But Paul in Romans is asking us for something more. The Greek verb he uses, proslamano, doesn't mean courtesy to a visitor, but enduring relationship. To accept another as a companion, as a friend. It literally means to take. In exactly the same sense, we sometimes use that word in our marriage vows. I take you to be my wife. I take you to be my husband. I take you to be my companion. Paul wants us to take others into our lives. So for Paul, hospitality is more than a friendly welcome. He wants us to accept one another just as Christ accepted you. A welcome can be transitory. Acceptance is for a lifetime. For one of our spiritual ancestors, whose name is John Calvin, acceptance doesn't simply mean friendliness, toleration, existence, but connection. This is what he wrote about Romans 15, verse 7. For Christ, having received not one or two of us, but all together, has thus connected us, so that we ought to cherish one another. I love those words. For Christ, having received not one or two of us, but all together, has thus connected us, so that we ought to cherish one another. But this is the tough part, if we follow Calvin's logic. Christ accepted us, therefore we must accept each other. But acceptance means connection, not a transitory encounter, but a bond that unites. In other words, Calvin is describing a covenant. In 1985, 33 years ago now, the General Synod of the United Church of Christ blessed the new open and affirming movement in a resolution that is remarkable because of that one word, covenant. Now, they could have said ONA statements or ONA declarations or non-discrimination policies, but they chose the word covenant. And that's what happened here in 1993. You adopted a covenant. And that's a word that has moral force in our tradition. Especially when I read the early church covenants of 17th century New England, I'm struck by the theme of connection. The Mayflower Compact of 1620 put it this way: we solemnly and mutually, in the presence of God and one another, covenant and combine ourselves together into a civil body politic. Those are words that are especially relevant right now. In 1638, the congregation gathered in Dedham, Massachusetts, professed, quote, "through the help of the Lord to live together in this our holy fellowship, according to the rule of love, in all holy watchfulness over each other, in faithful mutual helpfulness in the ways of God, for the spiritual and temporal comfort and good of one another in the Lord." Running through all of these early covenants is the theme of relationship, or as Calvin would have said, connection. The word together shows up again and again. We combine ourselves together. We live together. These were communities that wanted to live together in mutuality. And while it would be wrong to idealize these churches, they had their own share of disputes, schisms, and general snarkiness. It was remarkable that they wanted to begin their relationship as married couples often do, with vows. Especially for churches that lacked hierarchy or the constraint of external authority, covenant was the glue that held them together. They were contractual relationships grounded in the word of God. I think it was a brilliant move by the first generation founded the coalition and later the Open and Affirming movement to reclaim the word covenant. And because that word does have moral force, because covenants are more than statements, declarations, policies, or amendments to bylaws, congregations that adopt ONA covenants often find their relationships deepened, their bonds of affection strengthened, their commitment to the gospel renewed. The records of the church in Dedham show that their covenant was far more than a mission statement. It was the foundation of everything that followed. The saints in Dedham took their time. They gathered over several months for prayer, Bible study, and holy conversation. They listened to God's word for them. And what they heard was this: take care of each other. Take care of each other. They wanted to live in holy fellowship, according to the rule of love, in holy watchfulness over each other, in faithful mutual helpfulness. This was a high standard for relationship. And to me, this is a model of a successful ONA process. I've noticed that when I meet with a group of conflicted pastors and lay people who want to affirm their LGBT members and neighbors but are afraid they will divide the church if they even raise the subject, the word covenant will dispel the tension. Because then they begin to think of an ONA process not as another exhausting political struggle, but a rare opportunity for a congregation to rediscover its first love, its love for God and neighbor. Affirming an ONA covenant can renew and transform a congregation. I've seen this happen again and again. But that means living in the open, in public view. Because an open and affirming covenant is not a private contract, but a public testimony. Now, testimony is a word that can make some of us uncomfortable. It may sound preaching or too pious. So let me use two other words instead. And those words are coming out. I don't need to tell you that coming out can be a defining moment in the life of a lesbian, gay, bisexual, or transgender person. It means stepping out of the shadows into the light. But coming out is more than an act of personal integrity. It can be a force that changes lives. I know this is true. My own journey out of the shadows began in 1993. I was 39 and had just moved to Cleveland to join the UCC's national staff. A friend asked if I wanted to drive with him to Washington, D.C. for the March on Washington, the biggest ever gathering of LGBT Americans and their allies. It sounded like an adventure, and I said yes. We arrived late for the parade on the Washington Mall and worked our way slowly through the crowd. When we reached the sidewalk, delegations from every state were marching past. And at the head of each delegation were women and men in military uniform. Now this was 1993, 17 years before Congress finally repealed Don't Ask, Don't Tell. For the first time, they were openly challenging the policy that compelled gay and lesbian members of the armed forces to live in concealment. I knew that all of those service members were risking their careers and their futures and were willing to pay that price. Well, I'm a bit of a straight-laced Connecticut Yankee, and I don't cry easily or often, but I couldn't hold back. And those were tears of pride, but also of shame. Pride in those brave men and women who had overcome their fears, who had the courage to say yes in the face of the government's no. And shame. Shame that I had lived all my life in the shadows, afraid of my capacity to love and seek love in return. This changed my life. I returned to Cleveland the following day, and within 2 hours called and came out to everyone who was important to me. My best friends, my sisters, my mom, and dad. I was exhilarated, obviously. But I also knew that if I didn't seize the moment, it might be lost forever. But there's a second part to the story. It's my mom's story, actually. My parents listened but didn't say much when their son called out of the blue to announce that he was gay. 2 days later, I opened my mailbox and found a letter from my mom. I've kept it all these years. She wrote, "Your father and I have survived this long because we've learned how to avoid stress." And then she added, "You must never again speak to us of this matter if you don't want to hurt us." Now, I've always been close to both of my parents, and all my life I knew I could count. This was the first time my mom had ever shut me up. It felt like abandonment, and in a way it was. And for 2 years, there was a painful distance between us. But that, thank God, is not the end of the story. Something happened to my mom. First, she began to grieve for the loss of intimacy and trust in our friendship. And second, she had an experience at a funeral that changed her life. My mom had been a school teacher, and Phyllis was one of her closest colleagues and friends. Phyllis had a partner named Kate. For my parents' generation, when two women lived together, they were called companions. This was the cover that allowed them to be a couple without the risk of an open relationship. But Mom knew that. And at Phyllis's funeral, she was ashamed by the family's indifference to Kate. She told me later, "There was no one at that graveside who had more reason to grieve than Kate. And no one who was more neglected see, lives are changed when you come out. Those lesbian and gay soldiers who came out changed my life, and through me they changed my mom and dad. And that's why every October, the LGBT community celebrates National Coming Out Day. Because every story of coming out of the closet is also a story of minds and hearts that were changed. Every person who comes out, whether as a lesbian, gay, bisexual, or transgender person, or as a parent, or as a friend, every person who comes out is bearing testimony that LGBT people are not them, but us. And that's true for congregations as well. When you come out publicly as an open and affirming church, you are bearing testimony in two ways. First, you are reaching LGBT seekers who still may be surprised by the news that there are Christian communities where they and their families are safe. And second, you are disturbing the consciences of churches that still are unable to welcome their LGBT neighbors and who need a spur to action. For a congregation, coming out means leaving your comfort zone. You and I can't assume that adopting an ONA covenant automatically connects us to the LGBT community. Too many have been hurt by their experience in other churches. They're suspicious of organized religion as much as they hunger for spiritual family. It's not easy to take that first step through a church door. So we can't expect LGBT seekers to come to us. We have to leave the church and go to them. So coming out also means standing with. Every time you stand with your transgender neighbors who are vilified simply because they want to use a bathroom like anybody else, you are coming out. Every time you show up as a congregation at the annual Pride celebration, you are coming out. Every time you volunteer at the local LGBT community center, or advocate in your public and charter schools for LGBT youth threatened by bullying and suicide, or care for LGBT seniors who suffer abuse and loneliness in nursing homes, you are coming out. And every time you stand with immigrants and refugees, with Muslims, every time you stand with anyone whose freedom and dignity are threatened because they are different, you are coming out and bearing testimony. Another word for this is evangelism. Not as a forced show of piety, or spiritual arrogance, or moral superiority, but evangelism simply as living faithfully according to the gospel. Living our lives as followers of Jesus Christ openly and not in the shadows. In this sense, I believe, every Christian and every congregation is called to come out. A time will come in the life of every open and affirming church when we will ask what we intended 5 or 10 or 15 years ago when we adopted the brave words of our ONA covenant. Did we really mean that we just wanted to be friendly to everyone? Or did we mean that Jesus taught us to accept and even cherish each other? Did we really intend to wait inside our churches, expecting that lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender seekers would somehow know that our church door was different from 1,000 other church doors, that behind the door of this church was a place of safety, a refuge in the long journey? Did we really think our ONA covenant meant sitting and waiting? Or did we already know that hospitality means leaving our comfort zone and running as Abraham did, running into the wilderness to find the strangers and bring them home? I don't know the answers to these questions. Every church is different, and you will have to ask and answer those questions in your own way. But they are urgent questions. Because each of us has, at one time or another, stumbled out of the wilderness into Jesus' embrace. that to follow Jesus, you must, in Paul's words,